I've been fortunate to fish some really nice waters in my career, and today we're at another fantastic venue. We're at Brickyard Carp Fishery in Lincolnshire, a stunning clay pit, and it's also got some nice carp. Caught this one last night, also caught another one, but Sam the cameraman has just arrived, so let's get this one back and I'll show you the other one. But what a great start to the session. This is a right little angry one, but he's calmed down now. There's a look at the second one I caught this morning. So let's pop him back and I'll tell you a little bit about this lovely water that we're fishing. Well, there aren't many lakes in the UK these days that you can go to where the swims haven't got any names, but basically that's what we've got here. Now I'm going to talk you through the swim that I've decided to fish today. I don't know what it's called, but it's on like a pointy area. And the reason I've chose it is because when I got here yesterday, there was nobody on the lake. There's now three of us fishing, but I got first choice of swim. And this particular swim commands a lot of water. It's almost like a point. You've got this bay round to the left here, and then directly opposite, you've got that bank over there, which has got some lovely overhanging trees. Now, most of the features on clay pits tend to be in the margins because you've got that deep water. Going to the depths, you've just got a lot of that soft, choddy stuff that's down there. But in the margins, generally, it's quite firm. And you've got these nice little reed areas. You've got a little bit of weed as well. There's a lot of milfoil on the far bank over there. You've also got a load of overhanging trees, which are the features that carp absolutely adore. So that's the main reason why I've gone for this swim. Now my left hand rod, that's fished into the bay over there, and I mentioned earlier on about the big common in here, which is about 35, 36 pounds. It's only ever been caught three times, and all three captures of that fish have been round in that bay off the reeds directly opposite. So I've got a rod in there waiting for that one bite, hoping that that fish comes along, because clearly it must live in that area. But the main feature in front of me is on the far bank over there, which is at about 25 wraps. Now normally, if the lake was busy and there was somebody fishing over on those swimmers directly opposite me, then I wouldn't be doing this. But those snags opposite, I know there's a few carp in there. Yesterday when I got here, there was a few fish cruising on the margins along there. There was a guy at the weekend on the lake who fished in that corner swim opposite, and he caught one down the margins to his left. Now I don't like fishing snaggy areas when they're down to my left or to my right. I prefer to fish them opposite because you've got a much more direct route to the fish. So that's why I've decided to fish this swim and fish directly opposite to those snags that's over there. Now those snags, they come out on the water a good two or three rod lengths. You've also got the reeds over there as well. It's quite shallow compared to the rest of the lake over there as well. And as we've seen already today, there's a lot of sunshine that's hitting that bank. So it's a lot warmer, certainly a lot warmer than where Dave's fishing down in the bay to me right. There's a really cold northerly wind down there and you can really feel it. But on that far margin, it's nice and warm. And those two rods have got fished onto that plateauy area or that shallow margin that's over there. And I've got that direct line. So if I get a bite off the fish, I'm fishing direct to them. There's no chance of the fish getting towards the snags because I'm fishing locked up. The rods are all locked down as well. I'll talk to you about that tactic in a moment. But for now, just take a look at that as a swim. It's a beautiful area to fish and it's already done me two bites. Let's hope it does a few more, eh? True to Dave's word, bite time was from first light through to midday. The rest of the day, the carp really weren't playing ball. Despite looking for them and walking around the lake lots of times, I couldn't find them. So it's just a case of getting the rod set, ready for the evening, sitting back and enjoying what is a wonderful water, and hoping that something happened in the morning. So the sun's just about to go down and it's been a lovely day today, nice and warm, typical kind of springtime weather as well. Not so great with the carp activity today, not really seeing mainly boshing out or cruising around, but maybe that's because we caught a couple this morning. And Dave's been telling me that bite time tends to be first light through to sort of midday time, and that's when we caught this morning as well. So hopefully nothing's going to happen tonight, because I really do need a good kip. I was woke early this morning and I've been on the go today looking for fish, and I've only just a few moments ago redone the rods, so I've got those nice and fresh. There's quite a lot of rud in this lake as well, so they've been active, so at least I've got my areas nice and prepared, ready for the morning. So it's just a case of now getting my head down, and hopefully I'll be seeing you in the morning when something happens on those rods. The night quickly faded into another spring morning, but passed without any action on the rods. Fearing I'd been cleaned out by the coot that had been doing the rounds, I decided to freshen up the area. Repositioned my right-hand rod, I topped up the bait before sitting back in anticipation of another morning bite. I didn't have to wait long, as just 30 minutes later the rod was away again. Well, despite being on my rods and everything locked up, sometimes you just can't be fast enough for these carp, and this one has just put me in the reeds by the looks of it. So yeah, all locked up at the moment. Don't know whether the fish is still on, but I was on it really quickly as well, so just shows you really have got to be on your game when you're fishing tight to snags or reeds like this, especially at that sort of distance with mono, because there will be a little bit of stretch in it. So I'm not going to slacken off with this. If I slacken off in any way and the fish is still on there, then it's going to go further and further into those reeds. So what I'm probably going to have to do is, Sam's going to turn the camera off, he's going to have to hold the rod, and I might have to go out there in the boat and see if it's still on, if I can free some of the reeds from around where the fish is, or if the rig's in the reeds, I just don't know. Because they do have a habit of, for some reason, don't know how they do it, but they get into the reeds, take the tension off the line, and then shed the hook in the reed. So, yeah, frustrating, but that is snag fishing. Frustrations of snag fishing. No matter how much you're well prepared, you're on your game, I've done this countless times, sometimes the fish just get that one step in front of you. And I've just had a bite out of the blue. I was stood literally 6 foot away from the rod. It's tightened up, I'm on it really quickly, kept a nice bend in the rod, and it somehow managed to get into the reed. So frustrating, because it'd be nice to have a bite this morning. And what we did is Sam held the rod, that's Sam behind the camera at the moment, he held the rod, I went out in the boat to see if we could free the fish, but by the time I got out there, there was no sign of a fish, the rig was just hard fast into one of the snag stems, and how they do it, I have absolutely no idea, but they just do it countless times. Could I have done something different? Well, you know, obviously, where I've dropped the rig, and to where the fish has ended up in the snags, it's probably a couple of rod lengths, so it just shows how much stretch you've got over that sort of distance, and I'm probably fishing about 25 wraps out, so you know, I could have used braid, but there's no braid allowed on the lake, so if I was using braid, there's just no way that fish would have got into those snags, because there'd been no stretch. But you know, yesterday I was fishing exactly the same spot, I managed to catch a couple of fish from there, so it's frustrating, but yeah, just got to redo the rig, get it put back out there. But at least we've got a carp to show you now, because Dave, who's a couple of swims down from me, has just landed a mega 28 pounder. So let's go around and have a look at that. Oi, oi.
Yeah, mate.
You've got one, mate.
Yep, got one of the 28 pound commons.
Lovely, mate. Right hand rod?
Yep, right hand rod, just down here off the snag.
Oh, just off the snag, oh wow. Yeah, it's sort of typical really into these lakes, and most of the bites tend to come in the margins,
yeah,
isn't it?
Typical deep lake.
Yeah.
Margin fishing, that's all you need to be doing.
Yeah. Now they were showing mostly over your left-hand rod though, weren't
yeah.
they? The other day, anything on there?
Two nights I've showed over it, but I've not had one single occurrence, nothing.
Oh, right. Okay. So what's the fish like then?
Yeah, common, 28 pound.
Yeah.
Nice one.
It's a big one, a big decent one, isn't it? That?
Yep.
You know,
well
happy,
yep.
The 35, the 36 or whatever it is, and is this probably one of the second biggest fish in the lake?
Second or third biggest fish it is, yeah.
Yeah, wicked stuff, mate. So a young fish or
yeah,
a grower?
Fairly young, but be a grower, be a big one in the future.
Nice. Let's get it out and have a look
yep,
then, eh?
Get it out.
tell you what, mate, that is a proper chunk.
Yeah,
and it's really short, but it's got a really deep set body, hasn't it?
Angry as anything.
Yeah, I bet it was. I bet it put up a right scrap.
Yeah, it was boiling on the top and that snag just over there. Just kept it held firm and soon come away.
Well, it's got a good future looking at that, and it's certainly a rich water, mate. So now you tell me there's loads of nice big scalies in here, similar sort of size, so let's hope you get one of them, eh?
Yeah, that's what we want. We've had 3 commons now, haven't we? Yeah. So we need some mirrors and some scaly ones.
How many commons you got in here?
10 commons and what we've had 3, haven't we?
That's a good percentage then.
Yeah.
Lovely then. Let's get it back, mate, awesome. And get the rods redone.
Go.
So I've told you a little bit about the swim then and what I'm doing with my rods, but what I've not done is explain to you how I've set my rods up, because I am fishing tight to the far margin and it involves a little bit of hit and hold tactics, which needs a little bit of an explanation, because whenever you're fishing tight to snags, you need to make sure that the fish can't take any line off you. It's called locked up, and that's how I'm fishing today. Now, you can see my rod setups. I did say earlier on about me fishing with my left hand rod over to a margin round to the left there. Well, I've actually moved that now and I've got all 3 rods directly across to that far margin, because that's where the fish are. They're all patrolling along that margin, which is probably 25, 26 wraps out. And that's a good distance. And when you're using mono, there's obviously a little bit of stretch in that line as well. So you need to make sure that the fish can't get any momentum and get into the snags that's on that far margin. And the way that I'm doing it is I'm fishing locked up with my reels. Now that means that I've got any bait runner or any clutch that I'm using all locked down, so the fish can't take any line off me. And you can also see that I've got the butt ring on the rod this side of the buzzer, so if the fish does pull really hard, that's going to lock itself up against the buzzer and it's not going to go anywhere. You can also see down here that I've got a tent peg which is just pushed into the ground. It just keeps the butt section of the rod nice and hard to the ground, so it's all locked into place. It's going to make it really difficult for the fish to pull this area of the rod anywhere past that buzzer. So this kind of setup is something I've used a lot of places, like Rainbow Lake in France, where you're fishing in some really serious snags. I've done an awful lot of snag fishing on venues like that. Now, somewhere like that, you would be using braid rather than mono, where you've got no stretch, but unfortunately on this lake, braid isn't allowed and we can only use mono. And the mono that I'm using is 15-pound camo outline, which is really strong. But just to step my gear up, I've also got 3 rod lengths of 50-pound Shoctite, which is a braided material by Avid. It's an ideal material to use when you're fishing tight to reeds like we are today. Now those reeds over there, they're not fully grown at the moment. It's that time of the year where they're quite brittle. So hopefully the braided material is going to give me some extra strength. I'll talk a little bit about the rig in a short while, but other little things that I want to mention is that I've got the buzzers set really on high sensitivity, because I want to make sure that if I get any kind of indication on the rod, I know about it. So they're pretty sensitive at the moment. And at the moment, I'm just fishing for a couple of 3 bleeps, the indicator locking up and getting nice and tight, and then I'm on the rod. You can also see that I've got no clutter around the swim either. I've got the landing net well out of the way. I've got my chest waders already set up at the back of the swim as well, because I did get a fish yesterday where I had to get out in the water. It kited round to the right there and I was struggling to get into my chest waders because I didn't expect that to happen, but now I'm well prepared. My chest waders are all set, just got to step into them, and they're also to hand. So that's basically it. Now, obviously, when you're snag fishing, it is a case of sometimes you win it and sometimes you lose it. So we'll see how we get on. But I do think that the way that I've set my rods up, it's really going to give me a good chance of getting these fish out of here. But we'll see what happens. Fingers crossed. You never know, because some of the fish in here, according to Dave, they really do rock. And the big one in here especially, which is about 35, 36 pounds, apparently it puts up a right scrap, so it's certainly going to test the gear if I hook something like that, but we'll see what happens. What we're going to do now is just look at what I'm using. There's my boilies in there. Got some 8 millers in there. This is the bug from DNA. I've got some 18 millers. I've also got a few 12s in there as well. There's a few crush boilies in there. And all I'm doing is getting some pellet. Again, matching bug pellet this. Just getting some of this pellet, pouring it in. probably about 50% of pellet to 50% of boilies. And I'm just getting some of these tins of sweet corn, nothing special, just Tesco sweet corn, draining all the water out, just a couple of tins. Just get rid of that. Love sweet corn at this time of the year. It's a great bait, as long as you've not got too many nuisance fish in the water. There are a few rudd in here, but hopefully, if they're homing on this kind of feed that I'm using, they're just going to take the sweet corn and leave the boilies and the other stuff for the carp. So a couple of tins of that go in there. Drain that water off again. I know people actually use the liquid from these kind of tins in their boilie feed. They don't do any harm, but I'm draining it off today. So I'm just going to mix all of that up so it's nice and spread. Lots of different sizes of baits in there. I always think that confuses the carp. And then all I'm going to do is just get some of this liquid. This is the bug liquid from DNA. Just going to douse it all in a nice spread of that. Love the smell of this. Just smells carp at the moment. And this bait is doing an awful lot of big fish around the country. And I've got so much confidence in it. But there you go. That's a look at what I'm using. And all I'm putting out there is probably 3 or 4 spombs around each hook bait, and that's going to get the fish on the feed and hopefully catches a carp or two. So I mentioned earlier on about me beefing my gear up for fishing across those snags there. So we're going to take a quick look at what I'm using. And we'll start with the leader. I'm using roughly 3 rod lengths of 50-pound Avid Shoctite, which is a really strong braided material, which is perfect for fishing amongst lilies or reed beds as we are today, or indeed even woodwork. I've got that attached to one of our lead clips. I've got a nice heavy lead on there. That's a 4-ounce lead. The reason why I'm using a 4-ounce lead is because I'm fishing super tight. I want to know that as soon as something picks up that hook bait at that far end, I'm going to get some indication at this end so I can tighten down nicely to a 4-ounce lead. I've then got roughly about 8 inches of captive coated hooklink. This is 25-pound, and normally I'll be using 15-pound for fishing in England, but I've stepped it up a little bit, so I've got a bit of extra strength there. We've got one of our kickers. Normally I'll be using a size 6 hook in England. I've stepped that up to a size 4. That's one of our snag hooks, so it's super strong, perfect for fishing tight to snags like that. I know that as soon as I hook something across that far margin, I can give it some beef and get a better chance of getting it in. And then on the hook bait side of things, I've just got one of these little snowmen. I've got a little tiger on the bottom, and then I've got a small PB pop up on there as well, just to keep it nice and balanced. And the reason why I'm using a tiger nut instead of a boilie is because there's quite a lot of rudd about. I want to make sure that while I'm fishing overnight, I've got a better chance of that hook bait being intact for the morning and ready for bite time. Special water when you're just enjoying being here, and today very little has happened on the rods and I've not even seen any carp showing, but what a wonderful place to carp fish. It's just been lovely being down here. It's been nice and mild, nice and pleasant, just nice being at one with nature really. But we're going into the last evening now and we're approaching the hours of darkness when probably very little is going to happen. Our best chance is going to be tomorrow morning. That's when bite time tends to be. And hopefully we're going to finish with something tomorrow morning. But either way, if we don't catch anything, we've had a nice time down here and it's just been wonderful spending a few days at a venue like this. Absolute bliss, total silence, other than me rabbiting on. when it's all kicking off. I've had one just before first light in the dark and got it down here in the sling, and then I was fast asleep, proper hard on I was, and my left hand rod's gone, and I've got a right scrapper on at the minute, but we've got a few problems with a bit of this pussy willow stuff, the white stuff that's all over the surface. Let me just nip one pearl one a minute. It's all round the tip, it's all round the leader knot. So I've got a fish in close anyway at the minute, and it's a right scrapper too, so let's see if we can get it in. There we go, that's lovely. Yes. Oh. Whew. You always want to get a Barton camera when you do these little videos, but we've had three where we've not got the camera ready, but we've just got one, so job done, perfect. And the dog's awake as well. Lovely morning for it. Great way to start the morning. At last we've got a mirror carp, and this is an absolute beauty, I'm sure you'll agree. Put up a right scrap, so perfect way to end the session. But we've actually got another fish in the sling to show you in a minute, and it's a little bit bigger than this one as well, so brilliant way to end a fantastic trip to a lovely water. There's only 10 commons in this lake. We've not done too bad because this is the fourth one we've caught during this short session, and it's my biggest one as well of the trip at 26.5 pounds. A brilliant way to end, and a massive thanks to Dave for a wonderful few days fishing on a very special carp water in North Lincolnshire. Mega way to end, mate.
Yeah, mega
lovely
mega
fish
result.
Mate, so thanks ever so much for having us down. That is a lovely carp, and I know I keep saying it, but this is one seriously amazing water, mate. And
awesome,
I know it's got
mate,
a mega future as well, so.
It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, can't wait to join here as a syndicate member in a few years' time. Thanks for having us down, mate, and I hope you guys have enjoyed watching, and don't forget to like this video and to subscribe to the Avid channel for future videos. We'll see you again real soon.